all the time, and all the time the Lord is good. And I believe that God will be speaking to us today in the volume of His word. And I believe that God is set to do a new thing, because there is a growing up here. Something unusual is going on in everybody's life. And I believe that God has set the stage from January and is taking us to different dimensions of breakthrough. Today, I just want us to do a bit of prayer for the third month. The third month is a month, if you go back to history in the book of Esther, it's a month when the Jewish people have victory over their enemy. There was a vengeance of God upon the adversaries of the people of God. Hallelujah. I know the Holy Spirit is brooding and is moving, and you know, where these dispensations of the Holy Spirit, we are not living in the old, but we are standing upon the word of God, the God of victory, the God of vengeance, the God of mercy. And we are going to declare that this month will be a month where the Lord will make us to overpower all of the people that are, you know, contending against us. It's a moment when God will begin to do a new thing. Hallelujah. Those who have looked down on you, they begin to look up to you. God is about to set the stage. Hallelujah. Your enemy are going to follow the order of Haman tonight, and the spirit of Mordecai is going to arise. God will beautify you in this season and turn all of your struggle and challenges into victory in the name of Jesus Christ. This is the moment when the blessings of God begin to manifest and find expression in your life. This is the moment of the dispensation and the move of the Holy Spirit. Oh my God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God will begin to brood over your life this month. God will begin to check this and begin to release light to dispel darkness over your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Today is the last day you will see that challenge. Today is the last day you will see that word of opposition and contention in your life in the name of Jesus. God will disgrace and expose your enemy, and God will make you to be victorious in the name of Jesus. The hands of destiny will lift you up wherever you are in the name of Jesus Christ. God will raise a deliverer as He raised Esther for them in the time of this contention. The Holy Spirit is arise over your destiny, and every powers of darkness will have to give way. They will have to be disgraced. They will have to be judged by God in the name of Jesus Christ. This is the moment of your elevation. This is the moment of your victory. This is the moment, oh God, that what the Lord has spoken begin to find expression in your life. In the name of Jesus, you will follow according to the order of Mordecai, who was decorated. Somebody say amen. This month, you will be decorated. In the name of Jesus, whatever that was taken from you will be restored back to you. Whatever that has been falling in your hands will be restored back to you. Your job will be restored. Your marital life will be restored. In the name of Jesus, God will turn this around for you today, and you will have blessing. God will show mercy on you. Will show mercy on you. Will show mercy on you. Show mercy on you. God will begin to release mercy in the name of Jesus in the place of judgment. This is the moment of you going forward. This is the moment of manifestation. I decree blessing over your life. I decree victory over your life. Every sickness in your body, I command you to be touched by the powers of the blood of Jesus. I see restoration. I see victory in your life. I see joy unspeakable. Release peace. Release joy. Your children will prosper before your face. Your children will wax old before your face. None of them will be defeated. None of them will be a sorrow unto you. They will all be blessing unto you. You shall see the travail of your soul, and you shall be satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout a loud amen in the house. Amen. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Today is another day where we are going to talk about the power of God manifestation over those people that he has assigned to begin to make influence and impact. Somebody say amen. You are privileged to be here today as you are watching me around the world. You are not just tuning in and you are not just here. God will turn things around for you in the name of Jesus Christ. This is the moment of your elevation. As you are hearing and going to hear the word of God today, you will be transformed. You will be changed in the name of Jesus. God will brood over his word and perfect it upon your destiny in Jesus' name. I want to remind us, as we continue from the beginning of this year, we declare this year to be a year of influence. And because it's a year of influence, then we begin to speak into that purpose over your life. We begin to declare and bring to your remembrance what it takes to have influence. How many of you want to have influence today? How many of you believe that God has ordained you, assigned you, brought you on air to make impact and influence? Now, when you accept and agree on that word, what happens is that there are certain elements, certain raw materials, there are certain thought and thinking, hallelujah, certain decisions, certain spiritual exercise that will make you become what heaven had already mandated. I understand that people can prophesy on people to say, well, you are going to be great, you are going to be a millionaire. Maybe you have seen by yourself what you want to become. The fact that you are being prophesied on or you have a dream and revelation does not mean it will literally come to pass if you are not taking step about it. The major thing about prophecy is that somebody took a spiritual exercise, mental exercise, and taking action in the place of his destiny. The person that gives you revelation is not the one that will bring it to pass. He only saw it on the cutting of what you can. He only foreknow, but he cannot change. Somebody say amen. If you have foreknow about yourself, about your destiny, it is time for you to wake up to the God-given vision and begin to do something about it. Somebody say amen. The issue is not about just going around town and jumping from one place to another, from one pole to another, to go to hear what God says. When you study the word of God, hallelujah, in Christ, because you are now in the kingdom, it's just like you getting a pastor to come to Great Britain to begin to lay on how it is function here, and you begin to align yourself to a place where you can function, and you need to also, you know, make yourself ready for it and take your journey for it. If I prophesy on you, I'm not going to journey with you. You still have to pick up, hallelujah, in your step by step and journey your way to where you have to be. Somebody say amen. Today I want to strengthen you about a man in the Bible, hallelujah, who actually manifests and because he's a man of destiny, one of the patriarchs, I'm going to show you some nuggets on drawing on the strength of just who have lived before and how they go about being successful. Somebody say amen. And today I'm going to talk about the Isaac models of influence. And I want you to turn your Bible with me to the book of Genesis 26. The book of Genesis 26. Hallelujah. From verse 12 to 24. It's going to be a long reading, but it is good to read it so that we could apply the principle on this particular text. Either Old Testament or New Testament is the breath of God, is the word of God. The word of God never returns void. The word of God is active right from Genesis to Revelation. And I want to remind you, if you are watching me around the world, there is a difference between knowing the theory on how to quote the word and the application of the word. Somebody say amen there. Some of you who have been to university or college or you are doing your PhD, they will ask you to write about something and link it to a particular company or a particular people, a particular race, or a particular job description. How do you apply principle? So one of the things we do in our ministry is not just quoting scriptures, it's about quoting scriptures and also bringing and link it to people who apply that principle and how it was successful for them. Somebody said that. So that we can have a graphical understanding on people in the Bible. I'm not talking about people on earth now. People in the Bible are, these are the people I'm bringing to you for you to see how they operate. Even though they were in the old dispensation, it is still the same Holy Ghost that work in the old that they see working in the new. Dispensation can change, but the Holy Spirit is still the same. Somebody is saying the Holy Spirit will still respond, will respond to you, and is still brooding over your life. It's still bringing revelation to you. I mean, as a matter of fact, as a born again child of God, you are more in a better position to design and decode the mind of God, because we have the mind of Christ. Somebody say amen. Now, I want to you to turn into your Bible in the book of Genesis 26. Let's read it from verse 12. You can look at the screen if you don't carry your Bible, and you can get it all, reading your Bible, or you look at the screen there. Let's read together. The Bible says, then Isaac sowed in that land and received the same year and hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. And the man waxed great and went forward and grew until he became very great. For he had possession of flocks and possession of herds and great store of servants, and the Philistine envied him. Somebody say amen. And don't forget, as we are reading, it was the Bible that was saying that, and the Lord bless him. And we begin to see the manifestation of God's blessing. You see, you cannot be blessed and it's not, physically and practically express itself in your life. I don't just believe in quoting scriptures. I believe in the manifestation of what the Bible says. The Bible says, because of the blessings of God upon Isaac, the Bible begins to catalog different kinds of blessing. Hallelujah, that happened for him that we can tangibly see. So the intangible becomes tangible. Somebody say amen. And let's continue. The Bible says, for all the wells which his father's servant had dig in the days of Abraham, his father, the Philistine has stopped them and filled them with earth or with dirt. I know that a whole lot of people are trying to throw certain things into what you are doing, speaking negative into what you are doing, saying all kinds of stuff, but they are not the one that call you, but they still want to throw something on you. They want to throw trust on you. The Bible says they cover the blessing that Isaac was digging. Now, when we talk about digging here, we are talking about ancient, kind of wisdom and revelation, tapping into the way the fathers does something. Somebody say amen. He's trying to align himself to the platform and the system that are already in place. Let's read on. In verse 6, the Bible says, Abimelech said unto Isaac, verse 16, and Abimelech said unto Isaac, go from us, for thou art much mightier than we. And Isaac departed thence and pitched his tent in the valley of Gera and dwelt there. Hallelujah. A man that has the wealth that is more than the country and the nation he belongs, they could not handle the blessing. I know we have a whole lot of people today that God can release blessing upon to the point that what God gives you, hallelujah, which is possible, if we think right and follow principle, it will work for us. These are a function of principle. Because the first time that we read it, the Bible says he sowed at the beginning of the year and he reaped wonderful. There is an application here. There's a principle that the man followed. There's a system that is in place that the man tapped into that made it to enter into a hundredfold. So if you are anywhere and you are criticizing everything that God's spiritual value is not learned in theological school. It's not learned by anybody. Theological sense does not make sense in the application of faith. I don't care who you consulted and who you are trying to talk to, the things of the spirit don't make sense. It's a spiritual thing. It wouldn't make a sensual thing, because it is spiritually designed and decoded, and the man took a decision for that purpose. Don't allow people to put a restraining order on you to tell you how far you can go with your faith, because your faith is what provoked the supernatural into your life. If you are not taking step, you are shortchanging yourself in the economy of God, because God has got too much. The Bible says, according into his riches and glory, God will supply all of your needs. You cannot exhort that statement according to his riches and glory, hallelujah, because that was a decision that was taken that provoked you and provoked heaven to release abundance into your life. If you are not taking that step, you will be marking time and you will be looking at people, you will be envying people. The Bible said they envy him and they thrust him out. They envy him for his wealth. They envy him because he has taken certain spiritual decision. He has entered into a certain principle and that principle began to work for him. He connected himself to a certain system, certain possibility, and those possibilities begin to work for him. If you are here under the sound of my voice and you allow people to dictate to you as to how you relate to your God, you are the one that is shortchanging yourself, because there are diverse of degrees of doctrine that is going on around the world that is making people, hallelujah, to be walking in the wilderness of poverty. The Bible is the author of his word. God is the author of his word, and nobody can change it. And I heard that, I'm not knocking you, Pope Francis. Pope Francis has changed, hallelujah, the Lord's Prayer. And I will get to that in this principle today, because God got it for the first time, he got it right. This was coming from the mouth of God about the Lord's Prayer. So nobody can now come out to say, lead us not into temptation, because God does not lead you to people to temptation. I will come into that because it is the word of God. The word of God is perfect. Somebody say amen. But let me go further and complete the text that we are reading so that we can have a benefit. In verse 18, and Isaac dig again the wells of water, which they had dig in the days of Abraham his father, because his father is a principal man. Hallelujah. He saw the system in place and he wants to tap into it. Hallelujah. For the Philistines have stopped there after the death of Abraham, and he called their names after the names which his father had called them. He's trying to follow a system here. Somebody say amen. Now Isaac's servant dig in the valley and found there a well of spring water. As he was following system and he was following principle, as he went into how his father does it, something began to come out. There was a well of spring of water springing forth as he began to follow system. Somebody say amen. You see, when it comes to the economy of God, it has to be an individual thinking, because the river is already in you, because out of your innermost being shall flow the river. You have to unlock it. How do you unlock it? You unlock it by revelation. You unlock it by following system. You unlock it by following certain principle that the heavens cannot deny. The Bible said he dug the well his father dug in those days, and water came out. The people envy him and they cover it up. Anybody that is covering up your business is covering your business. You're discovering your covering up your increase and expansion. The judgment of God has just begun. The judgment of God has just begun today as you are under the sound of my voice in Jesus' name. I'll continue reading, all right, in verse 21. And let's say in verse 20, the herdmen of Gera did side with Isaac herdmen, saying, the water belongs to us. Hallelujah. Have you ever seen that you will labor so much, and after when did it begin to spring forth? After you have paid a whole lot of money to build your life, to build your business, and something begins to happen for you, and somebody came around to say, it belongs to us. They said, the water belongs to them. And he called the name of the well Ezek, because they strove with him. Whatever that is striving with you, he's being under judgment, under the sound of my voice today, in the name of Jesus. Let's go on in verse 21. Hallelujah. Because you see, this man continued taking. He never been tired. He kept pressing on, he kept pushing on. Somebody is saying amen. The Bible says in verse 21, they dig another well. Hallelujah. And strove for that also. They strive with him. With that also, and he called the name of it Sitnah. Anywhere where they attack him, they call it a name. Hallelujah. He says Sitnah. The Bible said, and he removed from thence and dig another well. Hallelujah. This one, we are in the month of March, which is the third month, is digging another third well now. Listen to what happened. What will happen to you in this third month is about to unfold himself before your eyes. And look at me, I just read it in verse 22. The Bible said, he removed from death and dig another well, and for that they serve not. They strove not. In other words, in this year, which is the third month, there will be no striving. There will be no striving. Whatever thing that is contending with you, an end has come to it in Jesus' name. Somebody shout a loud amen. Amen. I'm not hearing your amen. Amen. We are not in the cemetery. When I pray, you say amen. It's a resounding yes that this will happen. Yes and amen. Somebody say amen. Let's look at it in verse. As we read in verse 22, the Bible says, he they strove not, and he called the name of it Rehoboth. Somebody say amen. He said, for now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land. God will make room for you, and you shall be fruitful in this land, the land of great Britain, and the land where you are occupied, wherever you are, we yield harvest for you. In the name of Jesus, somebody say amen. Amen. The Bible says, hallelujah, he was fruitful in that land. And the Bible says he went up from death to Beersheba, and the Lord appeared unto him the same night, hallelujah, and said, I am the God of Abraham, the father. Fear not, for I am with thee, and will bless thee, and multiply thy seed for servant Abraham's sake, for the sake of his father. Now look at it here, and look at the principle going on here. I'm just reading, and I'm just reading to say something. I have not started preaching. Father God, bless your word, anoint your word. Let the entrance of your word dispel darkness. Lord, bring revelation from your word, that everyone under the sound of my voice will receive illumination from the illumination to clear your mind and your thoughts to kingdom thought of prosperity, kingdom thought of protection, kingdom thought of increase and expansion is coming upon you as you are hearing the delivery that is empowered by the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name we pray. Somebody shout a loud amen. I nearly finished my preaching, but let me just talk about Isaac. Everybody that look at Isaac, they thought that Isaac was a weak link. They see Isaac to be somebody who is very weak and he cannot fight a fly. So they always maltreat him and take advantage of him, took what belonged to him, took what he labored for. Ha ha ha. I'll the difference. Isaac is the best. Hallelujah. If you look at the character of Isaac, hey, God help us here. It's better than Abraham and it's better than Jacob. I don't know what you want to think about it, but I will unfold the truth to you today for you to know what we are talking about. If I say it's better, it is true by principle. Your children should better you anyway. They must multiply in your double anointing or the multiplication of your anointing. Your children doesn't have to, they have to start from where you stop. Hallelujah. So, somebody say amen. So if I said so, I know what I'm talking about when I said that Isaac has a stable life than Abraham and Isaac. And I'm taking you on a journey. Now Isaac, Abraham and Jacob, I mean to say. Now I'm just saying something here and I want you to listen to me. Because the beginning of a man's life speaks about his end. The beginning of a man's life is very important. Everything in the Bible is focused on a promised child that must come. And everything we are talking about as a covenant child that was delayed for many years, the time when God will respond, he responds to what he spoke will happen. Somebody say amen. Now, it is very important also When we have revelation, the Bible says Abraham never staggered at the promise. Because what is that promise? The promise of Isaac to come. Hallelujah. You see, every other areas Abraham had failed, but he did not fail because the Bible said he's going to be a father of nations. Hallelujah. And in the course of that, there had to be a promised child that was transgenerating and continue the prophetic word that every one of us now are living in Christ Jesus. Somebody say amen. Amen. So because of that, his life was guided. It came out of thorough fasting and prayer. Because the man is aligning himself to the prophecy that must surely come to pass. Somebody say amen. Amen. So when Isaac was born, I don't want to talk too much about it because we haven't got much time on our side. I can preach it another time, but there are certain things I want to quickly reveal. Maybe two or three principles I'm going to pick. We have almost about 10 principles. In fact, if I go into the New Testament, where the Bible begins to describe the heavenly Jerusalem that came from this lineage of Isaac, where Rebecca, hallelujah, gave birth to that promise. But let me just take you around and align myself to the principle that is very important in the continuum of influence. Number one, if you are going to make influence, it is practically, very important that you know who to marry that will make you journey in this promise of giving birth to the son that we are talking about, which means that the person has to come from certain lineage. And Abraham gave instruction. He said, don't marry wife to Isaac in this place. That is where he lived there. He said, you have to go somewhere else. In other words, the person that is going to marry has to share the same doctrine, the same belief system. Where he is, the system over there, he cannot pick any wife from there because of their way of living. So when he sent his servant to go, he said, don't ever make my son to move anywhere. He has to stay there. And the servant said, what about if the person he wants to marry, they wanted for them to come over there? He said, never do that. He said, God forbid, stay where you are. And the person that he's going to marry must be virgin. In fact, there was a blessing. I mean, the whole lot of this discuss, because you see, the person you are going to marry must not be somebody who is polluted, because something great is about to come from this lineage. Sometimes I want you to see yourself. Because if I follow theological principle, we will say that we are greater than Abraham. Though Abraham must have been born again, must have been picked at the time of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So he's in heaven. Please, let's take it easy. Don't condemn Abraham. Abraham is in heaven. In the time when Christ, opened the heaven, and all those cops and all of those people that were dead before, their faithfulness was accounted for them. Hallelujah. And they have the same resurrection. I want you to mark that, so that we don't carry ourselves too much of a big head, that we are better than Abraham in the new dispensation. Abraham is in heaven. Somebody say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, what I want to say is this. He has to marry somebody of the same kinsmen. Now, this is what I want to say. I want you to see yourself also in the position of Isaac, who wants to give birth to a promised child or promised children. Don't look at Bible to say that whatever happened there, the Bible said, the Bible was written for us who the end of the world has come to. So whatever was obtainable for them then is obtainable for us. If he delivered them, he will deliver us. If he promised them of a seed, is promising of a seed. If you say the seed is going to be great and mighty, the same thing applicable to us, that the seed that you are going to give birth to will be great and mighty in the land. Please don't shortchange yourself and don't look down on yourself. Don't make yourself look like you are less than anybody born. Because if you are born again, it is the same blood of Jesus Christ, hallelujah, that sanctify you. So you have the same equal opportunity like anybody that ever be born. So nobody is better than you. We have different ministry and different position. We pursue different aspirations that make us to be a mastery. Somebody say amen. But you have to do that too. To gain mastery, because there are so much of investment that was invested in you. The time when you gave your life to Christ, you reverted back to be the seed of Abraham. So if you're a seed of Abraham, hallelujah, the gene is in you too. Hallelujah. When you translated from the domain of darkness, God can no longer alert in your life. So you don't live in the family tree of your biological gene or genealogy. You are being, hallelujah, reverted or translated into the seed of Abraham in Christ Jesus. So you are pure. You are holy. You have the same grace. The same grace that was upon Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago is upon your life. Somebody saying you must see yourself to be important. That nobody put you aside or relegate you. It doesn't matter whether you have money or not. It doesn't matter whether you have stadium like or a small group like we are here. Hallelujah. It doesn't really matter. What matters is that you matter in the economy of God. And if you are diligent, you will walk your way to the up and you will make influence. Because the journey of life, where you are standing now, is not where you started from. It's a step-by-step journey. Every one of you that became a millionaire, that is controlling millions of people that follow them today, it was not in the way they were born that they all have that. Somebody walk on their life, they understand that God has got something good for them, and God has got visions and dreams for them. They are not running around the rat race or trying to look at if it's the Bible says, blessed is the man that cometh in the name of the Lord. So if a prophet came in the name of the Lord, the Bible says we shall prosper in what he prophesied. So it is not all prophets that are evil, but don't stop chasing the prophets. Because it's a whole lot of confusions. Because the spirit of Christ is a spirit of prophecy. The prophecy is already embedded in you. So somebody tell you that you will wake up and become a millionaire tomorrow, it doesn't make any sense. To yourself, you have had a dream where you are in a certain position, where you are promoted, where you are living in your mansion or flying your own private jet. Why can't you believe that? Because those things, they are taught in the heart of God upon your thought that could come to pass. But seeing it is not what is important. Giving you revelation is not what is important. It's not who you are in the kingdom and in the economy of God. And begin to pursue and follow after your dream. I spoke last time, yes, last Sunday, Joseph followed his dream. He was born a priest, but he needed to become a prince. But he eventually became a prince. But there are a whole lot of things that happened before he got there. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now, I want to talk to you about one principle. Number one, there is a promise and there is a choice. There was a promise that the bride selected for Isaac has to be chosen with particular care. Number two, she should be the mother of the multitude of nations, which God had promised will come through Abraham's seed. You must know that if God has prophesied into your life, when you are going to get married, you must consider that promise. Hallelujah. That the wife you are going to marry is going to be a mother of multitude of nations. It's going to help you, hallelujah, to control your words and to build certain areas in your life that you cannot do by yourself. It's your helpmeet. Hallelujah. And also, through her, the promised Savior will come. We are, I want to say this. I say that we are because we are little Jesus. He said, occupy till I come. Somebody say amen. So I'm not talking about fallacy here. I'm talking principle. If Jesus said, occupy till I come, then we are little Jesus. Hallelujah. Doing what he did 2,000 years ago. Somebody say amen. So through her, the promised Savior will come. You must know that there is a promised Savior in your loins that will give birth to, that will transgenerate you. So don't just do anything and just do anything anyhow, and you are not thinking generationally. You must think that, and if you are going to think generationally, you need to marry right. And through that Savior, all nations of the earth will be blessed. Through your seed, hallelujah. The Bible says the children of the righteous shall flourish and shall be delivered. I know that most of the time, God gave me a ministry in the spirit, which I will unfold shortly, that we should be praying for the children of pastors. It's very important we do that, because there are so much of attack upon their lives. As a matter of fact, there is something going on where, even these days, that the devil, not the devil, I'm talking in terms of by faith, that sometimes they can be used against your ministry. They can execute certain behavior that is anti to what you are doing. But don't judge them by that. You that know who they are, you speak who they are. Sometimes, oh my God, that when I was growing up, I knew how I lived too. But there was a prophecy upon my life. And I begin to wonder, I believe something also, that sometimes God will take people through processes. There are people that will go through processes. There are a whole lot of pastor children that are selling drugs, taking drugs, and taking marijuana, doing all kinds of stuff. But one day, because the prophecy must come to pass, hallelujah, God will make his word to come to pass without returning void of power. Hallelujah. The word of, see, sometimes when those people got saved, my God, they already understand that there's nothing in the world, and they are 100% zeroing on God. So allow God to take people through process, but we must be prayerful, because nobody wants to see their children wayward. We want to see them walking in the principle. We want to see them excelling in the things of God. So, but the enemy sometimes uses them against their own destiny. But God will align them in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now, let me continue. So the characteristics of choosing wife for a promised child is very important. No suitable wife could be found among the Canaanite peoples where they lived. In other words, you cannot live like in the world. You want to marry somebody and the person is wayward, is living like the Canaanites? Abraham said, no, that should never happen. He said, both Isaac and his wife must be completely united in their faith, in the covenant with God, in order to properly instruct their children in this faith. Abraham is giving something down to Isaac here. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. I said his wife must not even be a recent convert. He must be mature. She must be one who has been instructed concerning God from her youth. Hallelujah. I know that can be faulted, because then those days that thing worked because it's law. These days the spirit of God can touch people like Paul, who became Saul, and sudden change can happen. Somebody say amen. So we are not these people that will not be balanced, because in this new dispensation, within 24 hours, God can turn tides around and bring victory in the place of storm, in Jesus' name. She must be virgin. She must love her family, but willing to live away from them. Hallelujah. And these principles, they are very important, because these are training that Abraham was given. So they must have a semblance of Christ. You know the semblance of Christ in the book of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. Rebecca's marriage was planned long before he knew it, before Christ was born. We have been prophesying about Christ coming. So also there was a prophecy about the child that Isaac must give birth to. Even you that you will give birth to, you are a promised child of God. Something good has to come out of you. It has been ordained, predestined from the beginning of time that your son and daughter are going to be speaking in the language of the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of God is going to fall upon them. According to Joel chapter 2, verse 28. Somebody say amen. So what's necessary for the accomplishment and completion of God's purpose? According to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 23. This one that you are going to marry and this child that you are going to be born, he is going to follow principle like Christ. Christ was prophesied. Christ was prophesied of the thing that he will do. Somebody is saying, she was to share the glory of the Son. The glory of the Son. Glorifying it. The glory in John chapter 17, verse 22. He must share the glory of the Son. So the child that is coming from your loins are going to share from the glory you receive in Christ. Hallelujah. They are going to share that glory too. They cannot be disconnected. If they are coming from your loins, they cannot be a devil children. Even though there is an attack, if that attack will not stand, the word of God will stand to the glory of his name, in the name of Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. Let's leave that semblance of Christ. Let's deal with something else. Let's talk about, I know that, we can compare the life of Isaac to Christ, was promised long before his coming, finally appeared at the appointed time. Hallelujah. There is an appointed time when you will give birth to your children. I just realized the time when I married my wife and I discovered that all my children, hallelujah, follow the same protocol, the same calendar. We didn't plan that, but that's the way it happened. But there are certain principles that we put in place for that to happen. That all our children are born in October. And this happened because we had a fast, 30-day fast, from December, 30-day fast. That 30-day fast was what gave birth to the seed that was sown in the January that come around to a child that was born in every October. Hallelujah. And it's every three years. Somebody say amen. So they have a gap of three years. I don't know. We don't plan that. But the Holy Ghost is a good orchestrator. He plans everything. See, I want you to see yourself like God planning your life. He planned your children. He planned your destiny. That's the kind of child God gave you. It is God that gave it to you. It doesn't matter how they look. There is something in that child that was glorified that have the semblance of Christ. He was conceived, born miraculously as Christ was born miraculously in Luke chapter 1 verse 35. He was assigned an appropriate name by God before his birth. You know, other people, they changed their name. Abraham was changed to Abraham. Jacob was changed to Israel. But Isaac's name was mentioned before his birth. That's why I'm telling you that Isaac was different. Isaac was not following all those challenges, though there was challenging situation, but he has a power of faith to handle them. I will talk about that. Somebody say amen. He was offered up in sacrifice by his father. In John, 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, as we know that Jesus Christ also, the Lord offered him for a sacrifice. So, it's following the semblance of Christ. I'm telling you, what you are giving birth to must follow the semblance of Christ. Because your children are planned by God. Somebody is saying, if you have asked of the Lord, it will come from the heart of God. I remember that time when my wife first came. I'm giving testimony. And to any one of you that are listening to me, it's not about whether anybody is anything, but it's God's favor and mercy that is at work. I had too much attack in my life. To the point that the time when my wife came, he said, well, we have tagged you, we cannot kill you, we cannot make you wrong, man, we cannot, destroy anything concerning you, but you are not going to have a child. I said, no, that is from the pit of hell. I reverse that one. One day, I kneel down, I begin to pray by my bed. My wife was sleeping. While I was praying, I saw, hallelujah, A child that came from heaven and entered into the womb. This is a revelation. I'm standing before the presence of the Lord. As I finished praying that prayer, I just stood up and said, it is done. Not very soon. Within a couple of months, we started seeing the sign. The child came. It's a child of destiny. Every child that you have is a child of destiny. It was given of the Lord. Somebody say amen. Because you are a child of God. The devil's voice was nullified. If you are a child of God, the devil cannot do anything. I want to remind you, for anybody that are going through struggle, don't make your struggle to be it is the devil that had God power to put you there. You must understand that you need to grow. You must understand that you need to work on yourself. And if your life has not reached certain stage and certain system, there are certain blessings that you will not command. I'm going to talk to you about the text that we read. How they were digging well and they are covered. They are digging well, they are covered. At a point, they couldn't cover that well. Grace exceeded that attack. Somebody say amen. Amen. Was obedient. He was himself obedient unto death. According to Philippians chapter 2 verse 8, even Isaac was obedient to death. He gathered the wood and everything that was used to slay him and to kill him. The Bible says he was led to the slaughter and he was dumb, never said nothing. He accepted it as a sacrifice. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. You can see the comparative, you know, how his life followed the semblance of Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. He was brought back from death. Hallelujah. According to Ephesians chapter 1 verse 19 to 23. To be the head of great nation and to bless all people. Hallelujah. He followed all of those semblance. I'm just telling you that. When we are applying the word of God, we are applying principle here. We are talking about all the quotations that you quote in the New Testament. We don't even know who was quoting. They don't show their lifestyle. The old dispensation show every lifestyle of the people in the old dispensation. So that you can learn their failure and their strength and their weakness. Hallelujah. Because everybody has got a besetting sin that can easily beset them. It's not just about quoted scriptures. So I'm bringing a nugget out from certain qualities and certain characteristics that make those people tick in their time. Now let's go further to talk about some few things and we can see. Alright, we can see that everybody thought that he was a weak link. He was never a weak. He was the strength of both of them. Hallelujah. Now, from the text that we read, we can see how God blessed Isaac. Number one, he believed in the law of sowing and reaping. I know in those days, those that got water, they had always be the one that is very rich. There was an irrigation system that puts you in certain wet position. So Isaac has got a whole lot of people working for him so that they can dig that well. Whoever dug a well and bring water is considered successful in those old dispensations. And because Isaac has learned that trade from his father, he went to how his father did it. He followed the system that was put in place. He sowed that seed. In fact, listen to this. He had a guidance of the Holy Spirit to tell him that he must not leave. Even when there was a battle in verse 1, Genesis 26, when there was a famine, he wanted to run like his father. God instructed, don't even move. Stay there. Hallelujah. So he stayed there. He followed the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. He stayed in the land. Because you see, it's not about where you are. It's about how can you sow a seed to multiply yourself. It's a seed that leads to hundredfold multiplication. It is not where you are. It is what you do by principle. Where you are that launches you into that prosperity we have been talking about. And a whole lot of people that follow that principle, like in Genesis 26, Isaac followed that principle. The Bible says, he reaped 100-fold by that year. And because of that, they envy him. They said, you cannot belong here. You have to go. And the man moved. Hallelujah. The man is not like Abraham that is a warrior. That had a whole lot of people and go on a war. That nobody can challenge him. He moved. They said he should move. He moved. He dug a well of which his father had dug before. And as soon as water was coming out, hallelujah, those people, they put dirt on it. They want to cover him up. They want to strangulate him. They want him to go down. There are a whole lot of people that want you to go down. So they take everything that belongs to you. They take your property. They take your wealth. As a matter of fact, they can make people to be pushed out of your life so that you'll be on your own. That is the trick of the enemy. But you are not having covenant with people. You are having covenant with God. Somebody say amen. Those that have covenant with God, hallelujah, and they follow principle, God will always do what he wants to do. Nothing will be missing. Nothing will be broken. Because your dependence is not on the well, it's on God. The prosperity we are talking about is the blessings of God that was pronounced upon his life, that is finding expression in his life. I told you last time that when Abraham, or Isaac was praying on Jacob, he never gave him anything at all. It's a blessing that was released upon him. That blessing he carried around. When he blessed Joseph, it is that blessing he carried around. And every blessing has its own protection. Somebody say amen. So in their journey, they were protected because the blessings of God is upon their life. Somebody say amen. And look at it this way. He was not wondering about like his dad. So when the famine came, he listened to the voice of the Spirit. God spoke directly to Petrax and the Matrax. He spoke directly there. That is why when Rebecca saw Isaac, immediately he covered herself. Because they discovered that something has been transpired. I told you that there is a presentation that God will present your wife and you will decode that this is the one. Both of them cited themselves and decoded where they were, even when they have not introduced them. If you read the text very well in Genesis chapter 24. Now, I'm taking you somewhere now. Alright? So, let's go further to talk about how to maintain. Alright. He faced a different challenge. Now, the wife was a bit barren. The child is not coming on time. Now, when famine came to Abraham, he ran to Egypt. Alright? And God told Isaac, don't run, stay there. This is the man that is working under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. So when he was facing challenges, Rebecca did not introduce any maid to him. Neither was he looking for any maid to compliment. Alright? He was not making the same mistake as his father. He stayed with one wife. Hallelujah. He stayed with one wife. The Bible said he prayed for his wife in Genesis chapter 25. Verse 21, he pleaded, instead of getting another wife, he pleaded that God should make them fruitful, biologically. And because of that, God answered the prayer. Hallelujah. Because God heard his prayer. As soon as they became parents, they gave birth to twins. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. They did not allow themselves to take another extra somewhere. They say themselves, they pray it over that we are in this marriage. It doesn't matter what comes, we are for good and for the worse. We stay together. Whatever thing that is not happening, we shall plead. That they pleaded unto God. Somebody say amen. A little thing that happens for people's family, their family people has started calling them. Telling them that why you stay with that woman? Don't you think that that woman is barren? It's a barren woman you keep in your house. You cannot keep her to nothing. And you will stay there, grow old. Nothing will happen to her. You better look for something else. And they bring maids to Abraham. He collected. Even Jacob. Jacob accepted even Leah. Alright, he accepted another. You see, Leah gave him another one too. Hallelujah. He accepted all those maids. Because there was a delay. All right, and there is something happened with evil Rachel giving back too. And though he prayed anyway, and something happened, but he's a man of many wives. Isaac is the oldest among them because he was not polluted with too many problems from the woman or women. Many women, many problems. Many girlfriends, your pocket will run, will run down. Your life will run down, your destiny will run down. You will not have strength to push forward. Stay focused with one wife. Somebody say amen. Stay focused with your husband too. Stop jumping around town and be complaining about your husband. Stay together. Join hands together. Pray for every blessing that will come. Pray for every success that will come. So that both of you will have testimony in the presence of the Lord. So there is a challenging situation, but you never wander around. Somebody say amen. I'm just talking about the destiny of a man that will make influence. Is very important that some of these things begin to happen for them. In Jesus' name. Somebody shout it loud, amen.
Amen.
Now, I want to talk more about Isaac. Hallelujah. How he never allowed himself to be pushed around and how he was able to fulfill destiny. Now, when temptation and trial came, hallelujah, they handle it together. Amen. Now, I want to say something here. When temptation comes into one's life, I said that Pope Francis has changed our Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6, verse 13. He said that the Bible said, lead us not into temptation. Then he said that he doesn't want to allow himself to fall into temptation. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He said, there's too much noise around, but I want you to listen to me about the temptation we are talking about. The temptation, the root meaning of temptation, the root meaning of temptation, hallelujah, is has to do with trial, hallelujah, and has to do with test. So if you go to the root meaning of lead us not into temptation, it's not God, even though God gave permission for you to be tempted or tested or tried, it is somebody who we want to test because of the fact that God operated with us by choice. He doesn't want to push us for anything. Therefore, he allows us to go through trials sometimes or test whether we are qualified for the blessing. So for him to now turn around to say God does not lead anybody into temptation, that is a social statement that is going on around. I'm sorry, Pope Francis, I know you're in Methodist Church, it's different from Pentecostal Church. In the Pentecostal Church, we believe that Jesus Christ was tried, but he has the word to counteract. He has spiritual information to deal with the temptation and the trial. He has to be tested so that he can be qualified. Adam was tested, they fell. Somebody say amen. Jesus Christ has to be tested too. And it is the same test, it is the same trial, it is the same temptation. Temptation is an invitation to commit sin, but he never responded to temptation. He used the word of God to counteract temptation. Somebody say amen. So we cannot just be emotionally traumatized about the word of God because of the people that want to defend God. God got it right for the first time. Somebody say amen. When he spoke it, he has the foreknowledge of what he has spoken, that your faith will face trial. So when the challenging situation came against Isaac, he was able to overcome and triumph in the midst of trial. He never fight back. He began to move until he had a breakthrough. Somebody say amen. I see you having a breakthrough. I see you being triumph. I see you going forward. The word of God try him. Number one, the word of God try him. He said, don't move from where you are
And he never moved. Though the temptation to move came, famine came, he never moved. Hallelujah. Because he had a word. God is still guiding his people.
Yeah.
And he's still speaking to us. If you listen to God, you will not fall into temptation. Yeah. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
When the time of waiting for a promise child came, Abraham went for something else and came back to Hagar. That all the troubles are not the world now that we can see going on. But you see, Isaac never go for the second fiddle. Hallelujah. He stayed for the promise. Knew that the child that will be born is coming from this loins between a covenant between him and Rebecca. So he's not going to bring another Ishmael to create a whole lot of problem. I'm very sure there was a fight that went on between Isaac and Ishmael in their growing up. And Isaac must have realized that, you know, Father, all this thing would not have happened. You told me of what God has spoken to you, that you're going to give birth to a promised child. Why did you marry, you know, that guy? And look at what, you know, Ishmael is doing to me now in my own house. And you said, I'm a promised child. Look at what is going on. Then what happened is that at the end of the day, Sarah had a revelation. Don't forget, Sarah was a made track. Alright? They do hear from God. So when, hallelujah, Sarah asks Abraham to take the child out, Abraham has to hear another voice. For some of you who are pursuing prophecy around, God will always come. God is a God of dialogue. He said, hearken unto the voice of Sarah to take the child out. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So God is not walking alone and giving you a revelation from someone. You also have to confirm the revelation if it's coming from the Lord. I'm just teaching a principle here. But that's what I'm saying here. What I'm saying here is that trial, test, and temptation will come in this journey. So lead us not into temptation, or God, don't let us fall into temptation. Let me see the way he quoted it. He quoted it, and let's quote it right, so that we can digest the strength in what was said. And the reason why I want to say that is because some people are trying to make themselves to be the authority of the Word of God. The Word of God is authored by itself. So you are not meant to change what was authored by God. Somebody is saying, you are not giving authorization to change another person's work. Hallelujah. And then he said, this is what he said. He said, lead us not into temptation. That is what the Bible said. But he said, do not let us fall into temptation. Alright? Now they have changed it and they have accepted it. And they have changed the Bible. And then what is read in the Bible these days is this. Do not let us fall into temptation. That is what was written by Pope Francis. But the original word says, it says, lead us not into temptation. Alright? Now, it might look like, what's the difference here?
Yeah.
But we need to understand the meaning of temptation. The root meaning of temptation is test. So it's just like saying, Lord, don't let us be tested. Let us do what we have to do. Don't let us be tested. That is what it's trying to say. That God does not test his children, and God does not tempt his children. No, God does not tempt his children. And you say the other way, the original version, say, God does not tempt his children. But in the interpretation of the original, God tests his children too. Now we want to say God does not test his children. In Genesis chapter 22, the Bible says God tests Abraham. It was written God tested Abraham. So everybody will go through test. So you cannot run away from test. And if you know that you are living for God, you should not be afraid of temptation. You will be tested. And when you are tested and tried, the Bible says you will come out as gold. So we cannot see your gold unless you are tested. So let nobody change the Bible. We are not this world that don't understand theology. Hallelujah. The testing in the life of Isaac led him to triumph. It made him to be a strong link, not a weak link. Somebody say amen. He followed principle. Hallelujah. So there's no contradiction in the word of God to be changed. You can't change it. Because everybody's faith will go through trial and through test. We can only approve you. When, you know, as Saul was trying to give his weapon to David, David said, I cannot use it because I have not tested it. Hallelujah. Before God gives you something, you will be tested. You will be tested. So don't be too religious, because it is when you are tested and came out victorious, like Jesus Christ was led into the wilderness to be tested. He was tested. Somebody say amen. Your faith will go through trial and test if you are qualified to be the name that we call you. Somebody say amen. We are going to pray today. We can see how a man followed principle and how he was able to live a life of influence here. He was not this person that wants to be fighting all over the place. Not every battle we fight, according to Isaac. Sometimes we move. As they are pushing you, move until they push you into blessing. Somebody saying, the Bible said, on the third way that he dug, the Bible said the water gushed out to the point that they couldn't close it anymore. Can I tell you something? Every blessing that will come upon your life, it is because you are going through certain process and certain system. Until that system reaches certain stage, you will continue to be tempted, attacked, harassed, opposed. At a time in your life which you are consistent, hallelujah, they could not do that anymore. Somebody say, keep striving. Keep pursuing your dream. Yes. People might look at you and say all kinds of stuff, that guy is full of pride. It is because you don't bow down to their stupid principle. There are certain principles where you are at this a certain level of faith in your life. You don't want to listen to that. You are past that long ago. Some people want to fit you with something that you have outgrown. You have outgrown that system. There are systems that must work for you. That system comes with maturity. When you'll be able to handle certain weight. In fact, when you are walking on the road and you are carrying something, there are certain systems that make people to run to say, no, you cannot carry it. Let me help you to carry this thing. There are certain level of anointing that will come upon your life where the enemy can no longer cover you up, where they can no longer take what belongs to you, because God has involved in your process, and your process, hallelujah, you have been tested and you are qualified. Creation begin to support you. Heaven begin to answer for you. Somebody say amen. Everything you touch begin to be blessed because you have been transformed. Somebody say amen. Your faith has gone through process. In Jesus' name. Let's rise up. We are going to pray today. It's our communion and it's our anointing service. Let's do this and let's declare that there shall be no more striving in everything that we are gathering. Either in business, in your marital life, in all that you lay your hands on, strife must come to an end in your life. In Jesus, and lift up your hands and begin to pray. Begin to pray that strife will be over in your life. Whatever you lay your hands will be blessed.